Welcome everyone to my workshop, Serverless ML Models, Deploying ML Models to the Cloud Using AWS Lambda. I hope you're not all too tired yet, and I hope you still have some bandwidth or volume left on your LTE hotspots, because I know that the Wi-Fi here is quite bad, and I try to do this workshop with as little bandwidth volume usage as possible. I don't know if it will work, but I designed it the way that you can work with me and that you can deploy your models. I asked you to download a Docker image on the abstract, on my abstract. Who has downloaded the image? Okay, so I see there are some people who might need the image. I have one USB stick with a Docker image. So I can pass that around. So maybe someone, who needs it the most? Is there a cluster? So I don't know, maybe just distribute the image. And there's a how-to file on how to load the image into Docker. So maybe some people can do that while I do the introduction. All right. So who am I? I'm originally a trained biochemist, but I've been working as a data engineer at the Europace AG for the past 2 years. We are a company. We have a platform where we are a marketplace for mortgage products. So lots of banks, if you need money to buy a house and you go to someone, he hopefully uses our tools to give you the best price for your interest and mortgage rates. I'm interested in serverless architectures, functional programming, Scala, Bayesian methods, and stats. Okay. So, what are we going to build today? We are going to build a model. Not really. I have already built a model, so that's not part of the talk. If you already have a model in serialized form, that's fine. You can use it, I guess. We will, at the end of the talk, we will have an endpoint somewhere in the cloud, hopefully, if the internet is with us. We will have a Lambda function that does the categorization and the model will be stored in S3. I will briefly go into the details of what all those are and how they work. So first question, who has already worked with AWS before? Okay, that's quite a lot of people. Who has done serverless on AWS? Little less, maybe like 5% of the audience. Okay. So, the serverless evolution. Many of you, yes? Yes, I encourage you to ask questions. So, hopefully I'll see you and then I try to answer the questions. So, if you have questions, scream or do whatever to get my attention. as many of you know, I don't know, in the like 60s, 70s, we started with physical servers and data centers. The IBM mainframe might be something you all know. And as the way we developed software developed too, the software development process was getting smaller, modularized, iterative, and we also got smaller on the server side. So we went from virtual servers to virtual servers in the cloud, then we had Docker containers, Kubernetes, and right now the final step is serverless in the cloud. What is serverless? It's not really without servers. So there are managed servers in the cloud, but the different cloud providers, they just enable you to basically run just a piece of your code without having to worry about all this ops overhead. So like, I don't know, where do I put my servers? How many servers do I need? How does all that work? You don't need to worry about. So you just say, here's a piece of my code and run it. Why would you want to go serverless with your machine learning model? So lots of people build models all the time. Most of the time it's in Jupyter notebooks, which are great. In the last talk we heard how to handle deployment of models on servers and in a very structured way. But you might not want to deploy your model on a server. You might want to deploy it in the cloud and you want to show it to people and you don't want to pay for servers. And you want to show everybody, hey, here's my cool model that I built that can, I don't know, say, this is a citrus or this is a banana or this is a lemon, this is a banana. And everybody should be free to use it, maybe, maybe just your company. But that's the point, right? Yeah, there's some limitations of AWS Lambdas and serverless. So if you have very big models, you might run into limitations because you only get 3 gigabytes of RAM, and that corresponds to like 2 virtual CPUs, maybe a little bit more. I'm not sure right now. And the code that you need to deploy, so all your Python code that you use to do your predict, that cannot be more than 250 megabytes unzipped. So many of you know the dependencies in machine learning are hell. So scikit-learn, NumPy, pandas, they all get really, really big, and this is the limitation. But I will show you how to get around that a little bit. Okay, AWS Lambda. How does that work? So Lambda is a service provided by AWS. Azure has them too, IBM has them, but AWS, it's called Lambda. You can run a piece of code, it can be Node.js, can be Python, Java, anything that runs on a JVM, so Scala, Kotlin, anything that runs on .NET, C#, F#, they have support for, what's that new fancy lightweight language called? Go? Yes, thank you. And so how does it get executed? You have an event source, some kind of trigger. This can be lots of things. This can be, I don't know, some kind of log event. This can be, oh, here's an alarm, so do something. But it also can be, I have an endpoint, and if somebody goes to that endpoint, I want you to do something. And then you do something, and maybe tell your request giver, I guess, a response, or do something else entirely. It's also quite cheap. I already told you that. Yeah, you have something more. So you don't need to worry about scaling when you use Lambda. So if there's lots of requests, AWS automatically spawns lots of tasks that can work in parallel. From the get-go, it's like 1,000 on your account, but it's easily scalable, and you just give them a call in your company and say, hey, I need, I don't know, 5,000, 10,000 concurrent executions, and they say, sure, we give you that. You don't pay for idle, so you only pay when the code runs. You have built-in fault tolerances. If you have an error in your function, you can just say, okay, I have an event here which produced an error, but I want to see what that event was. So just put it into that letter queue. And you can do like synchronous, asynchronous, and stream-based executions. It's also pretty cheap. I use it for some private projects where I scrape data off websites. And you have every user has 1 million requests per month and 400,000 gigabyte seconds of compute time per month. This unit, gigabyte seconds, has something to do with how many gigabytes of RAM you give your Lambda, and then how many seconds it is executed. Okay. So API gateway. I told you that in order to invoke your Lambda, you need some kind of event. And when you want to do prediction endpoint, the internet has to reach you. So this is what API gateway does. API gateway gives you an endpoint in the internet right here. So you can access it from your mobile apps, from your websites, from your other services. It gives you caching, it gives you monitoring for these requests and responses. And through API gateway, you can talk to other AWS services, but it's most commonly used to access Lambda functions and just relay events and have the Lambda function do stuff. What API gateway does, it has usage plans, authorization, authentication if you care for that stuff, and I guess if you're from a business standpoint, you do care for that stuff because you don't want everyone to use your precious money or whatever fancy model you build. you have denial of service attack protection, and you have also Swagger support, so if you define your API in a Swagger template, you can generate the API gateway from that Swagger template. And also dust mocking and stuff. And it's free in the first year of your AWS account. You have 1 million requests per month. And after that, it's $3.70 per 1 million API calls, which is also very little. And you have a little bit for data transfer, but this is really not that much. Except you transfer lots of data, of course. How is an API defined in API gateway? You just say, hey, I need an API, it's called my car API, and you need this cars resource. And for this cars resource, you can say, I need a get, a post, and a delete for this this car ID, and then you can do stuff. How are we gonna deploy our API gateway with the Lambda and the model? So we use the serverless framework, and I don't know if anyone went through the trouble to deploy a Lambda function from hand via some kind of API calls, the command line interface of AWS, but it's a pain. So you don't want to do that, and this framework lets you just define very, very in a slim fashion what you want. So you say you want a function with AWS, and here's the code, or here's my entry point for the function that I want to execute, and you say I want an HTTP endpoint, ABCD. It should be a GET endpoint, and serverless does all the rest. So AWS, you can define virtually anything in CloudFormation templates, and whoever has written a lot of CloudFormation will tell you that it's a pain too, because it's really, really verbose, and you have to type a lot. Or you copy and paste a lot and do a lot of errors. So with the serverless framework, you don't need to do that, because behind the scenes, the serverless framework builds the CloudFormation. It has a huge community. There are lots of very usable plugins provided by the community for anything you can think of. Also for deploying Python code with requirements. and the serverless is infrastructure as code, and like in the talk before, you know that you don't want to do deployment manually. You want something where you define your deployment and where you define what you want. No clicking. And we also won't be doing any clicking today. Okay. So I hope the image has found some consumers and we should be ready to get going. Any questions so far? Okay. So I'll just put that here. So we can always check what we want to build. And then we are here. And I have to do something quick. Because I have many accounts, I don't want to use our production account to show you stuff. Okay. So if you have the Docker image and you have the GitHub repo, you can just type start Docker and it will spawn the Docker container where you will be in the from scratch directory. I have some stuff already in there. But we will start with nothing at all, I guess. Or just a main PI should be in there and a serverless YAML and nothing more. And you can use your favorite editor. So this directory is just mounted into the container, so you can use your favorite editor to play with the files outside of the container. So I could go in here and play with it here. But so you can see everything, I will just play with it here. Okay, that shouldn't happen. Okay. So how does Lambda work? Where does it get its information, its input information? For API gateway events that we will be sending the Lambda or that AWS will be sending the Lambda, you need an entry point for every Lambda, and it's called, or I call it the Lambda handler here, and an AWS will always provide an event and some type of context. So the event can be anything. In our case, it's a so-called API Gateway proxy event, and I have a little, I think I have something here. It looks like this, so there's a lot of information. We don't care for all the information, we just care for this part, and I should probably make that bigger. So it's a body, and this is the body that we get from the post request. We don't care for the other stuff right now. Can everybody read that? Is that large enough? Okay. So we get the body. Okay. But I got ahead of myself. Because what do we need to predict something? Anyone? Yes, a model. We need a model. Nice. So, as I told you, I already trained the model locally, and it's also in the repository. It's in the from scratch, there's just the model, but here's a demo folder, and there is, hold on a second, why doesn't that work? And there is a trainings folder, and there's the data that I trained. So it's a spam or ham data set. It's, I think, phone SMS messages, and it's spam or ham. It's from a Kaggle competition. It's all in the README. And what I did is just a base classifier. I just read the data. I create a TF-IDF vectorizer. I fit the data, and then I train a naive base classifier, multinomial naive base classifier on that vectorized data. And in the end, so we don't have two model files that we work with, I create a pipeline with the make pipeline function of scikit-learn. And this is the model we will be using to predict, because you see here, it has a predict function. Okay, so you can check that out to see how the model was trained. Okay, then let's get right to it. So you see here, we will store our model in S3. And if you have already installed the AWS CLI, you can create a bucket. And so we create the bucket via the CLI because it uses much less bandwidth than if we would go into the in the front end here and do it that way, because I guess not everyone has an LTE hotspot. Okay. And mine doesn't work either, so. Oh yeah, it does. But anyway, so let's create a bucket. I have to look on my cheat sheet. Okay. So how do we create a bucket? So if you have the AWS CLI installed, you just type AWS S3 API, create bucket. Then you say this is access control. I don't know what else stands for, something with access control. And you say it should be a private bucket, so not the entire internet can see what you're doing there. And then you just type in a bucket name. Let's see. Oh no, this wasn't supposed to happen. I just call it PyData Workshop. I hope nobody else creates one with that name right now, because they are globally unique. So they can only exist one bucket with that name. I can also just put some random stuff in here, but it's hard to type afterwards. And since we are central of Europe, I will just set the location constraint to EU Central, which is the service in Frankfurt, AWS service in Frankfurt. And this is also important for when we later describe in the serverless our serverless YAML, because if your serverless, so if your Lambda serverless service runs in one region, the bucket where serverless puts your deployment artifact cannot be in another region, so it must be the same regions. And we will deploy one in an EU central one. Okay, let's see if that works. Yay, we just created a bucket. So anyone have any questions? Does it work for everyone to create a bucket? Okay. Now we need to upload our model into the bucket. And it's just a small model, it's like 700K. So that shouldn't be too hard on your bandwidth. So you can do that with AWS S3 copy, and the model is located in model pipeline. And we want to upload it to PyData Workshop. Model pipeline, Oh, and let's just call it model. Model picker. Okay, and now it loads the model and it says, okay, I've successfully uploaded your model into the bucket under this this key. So S3 is basically just a key value store where you don't really have folders and files, but you just have a key, in this case model PKL, and a value, and the value would be the bytes of the model, I guess. Okay, now that we have the model, we can start programming the service. Okay, let's just close this one. Yes. Okay. Okay. As I told you, the Lambda handler gets the event, and right now it returns exactly just this snippet: status code 200 and a body result with which is just an ellipsis. So for API Gateway to send the client back a valid response. The response given to the API gateway by the Lambda must correspond to this. So it must be an object which has a status code. This is your standard HTTP status code. And it must have a body with the payload. And then there's also some other stuff where you can say it's base 64 encoded, but we don't need that right now. Okay. So now I can go into my Docker container and I can now type serverless to test if that works. Serverless invoke local and I guess it's input. And I just say the input event that should go inside my model, which could be right now anything, I guess. And now, oh no. Yeah, and now I get an error. Okay, why do we get an error? The reason we get an error is that we haven't defined our serverless service yet. So if you look in the serverless YAML, it's empty. And it's empty because we haven't written anything down yet. But I can tell you how you can test this nonetheless, kind of like it would actually be executed on the Lambda. And you can do it if you type Python C for command. And then you just say import main, which is the main py. And now we can say print. And the Lambda handler is our function. And we put something in there, hello world. And the context doesn't interest us right now. And this would probably go wrong, because we just need single ticks. And it says Lambda handler not defined. That's interesting, because it should be main Lambda handler. And now it says, I've executed this snippet. There's nothing in there. It just returns this. Okay. Now to the interesting parts. What do we need to get a result? We need to predict something. So we need to predict this something from the event. Because in the event, there will be our payload. It will be just a text snippet. So it will be, I don't know, hello world, hello, I'm at PyData doing exciting stuff, and we would want to predict if this is spam or ham. So we use the event. So now we need to define a predict method, which I guess gets in an event and then does something and returns a result. Okay. We know that the model has a predict method, so we just say here model predict. And I told you that we need the body of this event, so we just get this body. And we predict something from this body. Okay, so far so good. But we don't have our model yet. So we need the model. And I guess to get the model, we also need some kind of function where we say get model. So we know that our model is stored on S3. To access the model from S3, we use a library called Boto3. And interesting but totally useless fact: Boto is the name of the Amazon River dolphin, and that's why it's called Boto. I don't know. That's what some AWS guy said. It's just completely useless knowledge, but whatever. Okay, we need to import this, of course, Boto3. And in the Docker image, all the dependencies that you need to run this code are included, so you don't have to install anything to keep bandwidth volume low. So Boto3, there's a concept called resource, which will be an S3 resource because we want to access S3. And in S3, we want to access a bucket, and it's called PyData Workshop, if I remember correctly. And this will just be our bucket. Okay. And now we can say bucket download file object, and the file object has a parameter key, and this is the key of the model. So it was model PKL for me. You have to put in your bucket and model information. I don't know where your model and bucket is. Okay. And we want to download it not onto the disk, but inside a file object. So we say here file object, and it's just, I guess, model. Okay, we don't have a file object yet, so let's create one. No, it's not open, it's bytes.io because we want to do it in memory. So it's with bytes.io as model, and you have to import, I guess, from IO import bytes.io. So this is in the Python standard library. Okay, so now we have the model inside this this model object. And we can now deserialize it. So we just say, okay, maybe this is a bad name for this. I just call it model file object. So now I can say my model is, and now we need to deserialize it. I serialized the model. I pickled it with the joblib. library from the scikit-learn externals. So it's job lib load and model fo. And this will load the model inside this model object. And of course, we have to import this from sklearn externals, import joblib. Okay. So I guess, yes, thanks. We have to return it. Return the model. What's that? Oh yeah, thanks. So I guess I'm looking at my cheat sheet here right now. Ah, thank you. So it's result from the prediction. Okay. So we can now try to run this. And this will go wrong because it doesn't accept the string. So we have to use some kind of dictionary with a body field. And I just say, am I spam or ham? Okay, and now we run it and see what happens. Oh, we get a error, unexpected argument. Oh yeah, that's right. I need an E. Oh shit. File object. Try it again. And this says something forbidden. I cannot access my own bucket. This is strange. This shouldn't happen. Did I call it PyData Workshop? Oh no, I know what went wrong. I created the bucket on a different account because I created this bucket in this top window where there's some other account. So I will just create another bucket right here. Now it can't be called PyData Workshop. So I just call it PyData Workshop 2. Okay. And let's try it again. What's that? Oh, yeah. Well, thanks. Yeah, live programming is harder than I thought. It's my first rodeo. Okay, model pipeline, and I set S3, PyData, workshop, 2, model, PKL. All right, now. And I expect another error message. Yeah, it says, iterable over raw text documents expected string object received. And does anyone spot the error? It is hiding right here. Here we have a string, and the predict function needs a list. So I guess we can just do it like this, and this should return something now. Yeah, hey, it says, thanks. This is still not in the cloud, it's still on this machine. So don't clap yet. okay, but now we here have an array, some kind of NumPy array. And I don't want that. I want a list, and I just want the first item of that list. And this should now just be a string inside the body. Yeah, it says ham. Okay, cool. Anyone have any questions so far? No? Okay. So now on the local machine, it looks like this works. We just need to get it onto AWS. So let's do it. Let's go over to the serverless YAML. And the way you define a serverless YAML, so we have to define all this. We have to define what is the API gateway, what is the Lambda, and the model store we hard-coded right now into the code. To optimize this, you wouldn't do this in production to hard-code that. You would probably use some kind of environment variable to get it set inside the Lambda. Okay, serverless. You define a service, and you can call that service however you like. I also am very unimaginative, and I just call it PyData Workshop. Now, serverless needs to know, because it can use AWS, Azure, Google Cloud Functions, and OpenWhisk. It needs to know where we want to deploy it. So you just say you need provider section. This doesn't look right. And in the provider sections, you say you want to use AWS. And since you can use multiple runtimes, Java, Node, C#, or Python, we need to also tell serverless what runtime we want. So it's just the runtime, and we want Python 3.6. You can also use Python 2.7, but I heard that 2.7 should now be called legacy Python. And you shouldn't use it anymore, except if you really, really have to, because support will be deprecated, I guess, from 2020, end of 2019. So there won't be any more updates. Okay, and we also need to specify a region. And since we created our bucket in Europe Central 1, we also want our Lambda to run in Europe Central 1. Sweet. Now we have to tell serverless where to put our artifact, our code. How do we do that? There's a field deployment bucket. And there you can just say, I hope this YAML is still formatted right after. And you can say what bucket you use. And I would just suggest we use the same bucket that we stored our model in, which is PyData Workshop. Okay, sweet. Last but not least, we need to tell serverless what kind of functions we want to deploy. So you do this with another field, functions. And you can have multiple functions inside a service, but right now we're just defining one function. And this function, I will just call categorize lambda. And it will also need a name. So, also very unimaginative. This is the name. This is the name that is displayed in AWS when you go inside the AWS console, and this is the name that serverless will use to create resources, so create CloudFormation resources when it does its magic. If in case anyone was wondering why I wrote one with a dash and one with an underscore, I guess I could also write here a dash, but yeah. Okay, we can put in a description if we like. A lambda prediction function. Oh, typing is bad. Okay. Right now, AWS and serverless doesn't know where to jump into my code. So I have multiple functions. I have a prediction function, I have a get model function, I have a lambda handler function. And I need to define where should AWS jump into my code. And this happens with the handler. And the way you do that is you say what package, basically, or what file, and it's just the main PI, and there's the function lambda handler that we defined. in case you wondered, you cannot go arbitrarily deep in this, so you cannot have your entry point somewhere, I don't know, deep inside your package hierarchy. It can only go two levels deep. So you might have it in another directory, then you could say like directory. And this directory also needs an init PI. And then you can do it like this, but if you want to go like this, this wouldn't work. Okay. This is limitations by AWS. Okay. Any idea what we need next? Need some working with you. Shouldn't be tired already. Get some coffee. Anyone? Yes, we need an event. Thanks. So we can define events also under the functions, and there are multiple events in AWS. And you can also define multiple triggers. So this is a list of events, and we will have one HTTP event, and this will be a post. And the resource should be spam or ham. But you can also have, if you have like SNS or some queues, SQS, like last week Amazon announced that SQS is now supported or available as an event trigger in Amazon AWS Lambdas. This is new. This is something people really wanted. Yeah, just if anyone is interested. Okay, see. Okay, now we have defined our serverless YAML. We can try testing with the serverless test. So serverless invoke local. And I guess I will need something like this. Very, very unimaginative. Ah, yeah. And serverless tells me right now, hey, you told me to invoke something, but I don't know what to invoke because you didn't give me the name of the function. So I have to tell serverless what the function name is. And I do this with F, categorizer lambda. Okay. Is this? Ah, categorize lambda, thanks. Yeah. Okay. I guess now it's the underscore, thanks. Yeah. Okay, it says, yay, it worked, but there's no body in the event, and I'm guessing I have the wrong This is probably not the right one. Maybe it's data. No. I have to check my cheat sheet again. I wrote it down somewhere here, I guess. Who knows? Right here. Data. Oh, single ticks, okay. So the single ticks should be outside and the double ticks inside. Who would have known? Okay, and here it says, all right, I can now use serverless to test the functions. I can now also use serverless to deploy the functions, but right now serverless will only upload my main Py because it doesn't know out of the box anything about my dependencies. But there's help. There's a neat little plugin, a serverless plugin called serverless Python requirements. And this will read in requirements.txt or pip files. By the way, if you develop applications, you should really use pip files. It's supposed to be the new standard, and it's really nice working with it. It does your virtual environments and all the dependency management, so you always have the right versions and you don't have version clashes. And also you can export the versions into requirements.txt if you need to. Okay, any questions? Yeah. So the question, it says here, do you have the function categorized lambda doesn't exist?
No, this one exists.
Oh, and it says you can only invoke Node.js, Python, and Java functions locally. And I guess you might not have put the runtime Python 3.6 up there. Okay. So there was a problem where serverless basically, maybe I can tell you or show you, I don't know, can just say go, I guess. And yeah, he got this error, so you can only invoke Node.js, Python, and Java functions locally. Okay. Where was I? Yeah, the requirements. There's a plugin called Serverless Python Requirements, and this manages packaging of requirements from the requirements.txt. I already put a requirements.txt in the repo too, in the folder. So you don't need to worry about what we need to install. And unfortunately, I couldn't package the plugin globally inside the Docker image. So we have to install it. it's called serverless Python requirements. Yeah, serverless is a Node.js-based framework, so you can use npm to install the plugins and stuff. And serverless looks into the folder it's located. If there's a Node modules folder, it looks there for dependencies. Okay. And don't worry about the warnings. This is just telling you that you don't have a package JSON, which you don't need right now. If you ever go into production with serverless services, you should have a package JSON so you can really define there which versions your plugins are and your serverless installation. So you are safe on that end. Okay. And now I can tell here on top in my serverless YAML that I need plugins, and the plugin I want to use is called serverless Python requirements. Did the installation finish for everyone?
I cannot, because you don't have permission to set it for them.
Are you running Linux or Windows? This is interesting. So, did you install it like this or with a G?
Like this.
Are you in the same folder, in the from scratch folder? Okay. If you want to go outside of the container, so outside of the container, so I might be. Let's see. So you might want to do a change ownership with as a sudo, where you just give your user the read-write permissions, and then it hopefully will work like this. And then you should be able to install it. Okay, great. All right. So now we have that installed, we can actually deploy the service. So, well, actually, if we deploy the service now, there will be an error, and I would like to you to see the error so we learn more, I guess. But in order to preserve your precious bandwidth, I will tell you to get rid of how to get not get the error when you deploy, and I will then delete the code again with my service to get the error and show you something. Okay. So when we deploy now, the way authorization and what services inside AWS can do, the way that it works is with policies and roles and users. So you have all these kind of concepts. So the user is can be in groups, and the groups have policies attached to them that tell AWS this user can do that and this user can do that. With AWS services, so if you run an EC2 instance or a Lambda, these are not users, but you still want to restrict certain services to do something. And the concept there is roles. So these services, they can assume a role, and this role is then connected to policies which tell the service what it can do. Serverless, when you deploy a function or a service, it will automatically create a role that your function uses with the most, I guess, basic rights that you need to have. And right now, those rights don't contain access to the bucket, to the S3 bucket where we stored our models. So we have to tell serverless, hey, I also want access for this role to this bucket. Okay, and we do that with a section called IAM role statements. And this is, now you see how policy statements are created. So each statement has an effect. Right now it's allow, So the standard is in AWS, you cannot do anything unless you're allowed to do it. So it's whitelisting yourself for certain services. Okay. And the actions that we want to execute are S3 actions. So S3 get object is all we need. And the resource that we want to get the object from. And now, what was that question? Oh, okay. And the resource that we get our action, want to do the action on, is and now it's an ARN. It's a kind of how AWS namespaces its resources and its services. So it's just a unique identifier to get to define where we want to go. So it's ARN AWS S3, and then it's three empty dots. Usually there would be a region defined there and an account ID, but for S3 we don't need that. And in the back it's just the PyData workshop bucket number 2, and we need a star at the end. So this allows this role basically to get an object that is stored in this bucket. Okay. Yeah. Yes. So right now we have two models. One is stored in the other bucket. That's true. But the other bucket is in another account right now. And we, I don't know, maybe it's up here somewhere. If you can remember, we also stored the model in this bucket, I guess. Up here somewhere. No. Yeah, it was here. So we created a new bucket, PyData Workshop 2, and then we also uploaded a new model into this bucket. Oh. Okay. So this is why it says PyData Workshop 2 right here. Okay. Now we should be able to deploy the service. And what it does now, right, it installs the requirements from the requirements txt, and then it packages them and uploads them to AWS. And unfortunately, as I told you before, machine learning requirements are quite large. And I don't know how long this will take, but in the end there should be a working endpoint, and I can show you how it would look like when it's done. So I will have to check how my endpoint is called right now. So I've already tested this, so I can show it to you now. I've already created another API endpoint, and I just need to get the URL where I can reach it, because I didn't really write that down. Okay, so I can show you now. Let's do it like this. I can now do a curl post on this endpoint, and it's called spam or ham. And I can say, what a lovely audience I have here today. And then hopefully, if it doesn't break right now, okay. Maybe I did something wrong. Obviously, I did something wrong. What's that? Oh yeah, yeah. I know what the error is. We didn't say this is data. So forget when you forget your curl. Did that work? Yeah, right here it says ham. Okay, so there was nothing wrong with the service. I was just missing a minus data. Okay. What's the status right here? It is still installing. Okay. We have 23 minutes left. Since I already told you that the Python requirements are quite large. I was doing something. And I told you that there are lots of really, really nice plugins for serverless. And this serverless Python requirements plugin does something magical. Because every Python package that you install, there are lots of tests in the packages. But if you deploy the packages, you don't need really the tests. Because you should be in production. No need to test in production. And there was recently serverless you have the option, there's like a custom field. Where you can say for the Python requirements package I want the option slim to be enabled. And what this does is it removes all the test code. I'm thinking it removes like data sets too, or at least if it doesn't do it, you can tell it to do it, to remove data sets. It removes some of the PyCache files and some other stuff. And what it also does, it strips unnecessary code from binary dependencies. So lots of machine learning packages in Python, they rely on C code. It's the something .so files that you see, that those are the libraries. And the libraries are sometimes quite large, and there's lots of, I don't know, comment code in there. And this plugin also strips that. So the requirements, at least as you upload them, become much less. So right now you see that I upload a 61 megabyte file. And when I strip the requirements, when I use this this slim, this will go down to like 38. So it's quite nice. And you should be using that. Okay. Any questions? Yes. Yes. So the question was, what does serverless do right now? Serverless installs the packages. So it uses like a temporary directory where it installs everything I provided in the requirements .txt. Then it zips those dependencies and also my code inside the dependencies. Then it uploads the code to S3. To this deployment bucket. I can show you right now what that looks like. So right here. So yeah, this is where we put our model. and serverless creates, when you tell serverless here, this is the bucket where I want you to put my code. It creates a serverless key, I guess, and it tells you for every service that you have, it creates a directory, and then serverless is also staged. If you work with staging, dev prod, or whatever, you can also do that. And the standard stage in serverless is always dev. It creates a stage inside the service, and inside the stage, for every deployment, you get like a deployment ID and a timestamp when it was deployed. And inside of this, there is the compiled CloudFormation template, and we can look at that. So you can see for like this little serverless, what we wrote, this would be the CloudFormation equivalent. So it's quite some overhead that you save. and oh, you want to see the gateway in the CloudFormation? Yeah. Okay. So yeah, in the serverless YAML, right here the events. Oh no, where it creates the CloudFormation in here, down here, you mean? Yeah. Yeah, it's creating the API gateway as well, and you define this right here. So you say events. And you say HTTP, and this is the API. So you tell it you want an API where you have a resource, spam or ham, with the post method. And this is where this service translates this into the API gateway. And I can show you the API gateway resource right now. So yeah, it's right here. So. It says that's the REST API that we have, and we have this resource, spam or ham, where it says, it's a spam or ham resource, and we have a post method, and I don't know why it doesn't show. Oh, it's back here. This is maybe in the raw data. No. So, yeah, it's... It's basically, it says, this is the REST API, this is the name of the API, some other stuff, some types, the resource, so this is the spam or ham resource, and then you say, I also have a post method on this very resource, so it references this resource by the ref command, so it knows, I need to look up here, and it says... the integration type, so it's AWS proxy. So this means I relay this event to the Lambda, and the Lambda does the magic. There's another way to integrate with AWS Lambda. It's not the proxy integration, it's the Lambda integration. And there you can define in a template language, like in Velocity, it's called, you can define which parts of the event that comes to API gateway. So if there's like query strings or parameters, headers, you can transform the headers with the Velocity template, but you do this in the API gateway and not in the Lambda. And I advise you to just do it in the Lambda because it's way easier when you know this is the only logic you have, and not there's some logic defined in the API gateway that does something. I don't really know what it does. It seems easier, and if you ever go to like AWS people and they do like live coding, they always use the Lambda integration because there you could just like in your code. In your code, you wouldn't have to do the body and extract. And if you have like fields in the body to extract these, you could just say like, I have a field A or something like this. But I always advise to use the proxy integration.
So if I wanted to like configure more of the API, like the rate limit or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, The question was if we wanted to configure more than just the endpoint and the method, could I do that? And the answer is yes, you can. You can configure here if there should be logging, I guess anything that you can really set in the API. So logging, throttling, you can even say you want an authorizer. So before this request is relayed to your Lambda and processed, you want something to authorize the call to this endpoint. And when then somebody asks your endpoint, API gateway would just say, okay, before I do something with it, I just give necessary information to the authorizer. This could be like an authentication header, authorization header for like JWT tokens, or something. And then the authorizer maybe checks this token for validity and says, okay, this user really is allowed to access this resource. So you can do that too. Yeah. And this might also be another Lambda function. So you can also say, my authorizer is another Lambda function. And then you just give the request headers to the Lambda function. And the Lambda function checks and says, yay, you can go. Or nay, you can't. After the serverless deployment is complete, you also get all the endpoints it has created. And we probably should try this too, just to check if we did everything right. Almost finished. And there are also some ways. So yeah, it says ham right here. And this is a curl, I don't know. Curl is stupid that way that it just never breaks the line. But yeah, it works with the stuff we just wrote. Are there any more questions?
Shall we then use microphones?
Yeah. So while the microphone is going up, I'm just a quick side note. You can also optimize a little bit your code, because right now here we download the model every time, and you can also just, if you define this call as like a global, and you do like this, this only gets executed once. And you can wrap stuff like that I/O in the globals or in singletons, and you save some time. Yeah.
Thank you for your talk. And is there a max file size for the upload, or what is the max file size for the upload of the server service zip file? And what would you do if you exceed it for like with huge dependencies?
Yeah, this is a very relevant question. We have that, the maximum file size of the extracted. So you zip file, but when the Lambda is executed, it gets extracted, and there's a maximum of 250 megabytes if you do it in CloudFormation. If you have just the Lambda here, right here, and you say, I want to upload a zip file, there's a limit of 50 megabytes for the zip file. And what can you do against it? So one option I showed you is that you use plugins like this. So the Slim strips away the test code that you don't need. It's like 10 to 15%, sometimes 30. What you do is you use the dependencies and you zip them, and then you make another zip file. So when it's extracted on Lambda, the zip file is extracted and still compressed, and then at runtime you can extract this, and then you don't have that. So there's another trick, but it will take a long time to cold start the code, because every time the cold start, so it's just a container running underneath, Every time the cold start happens, it is extracted and it takes a few seconds. After that, it's fine. But this is something to keep in mind. And I've also heard people put their dependencies on S3. And when the service starts, they download it from S3 and use it then. Yeah.
Hi, do you happen to know the command for sort of some different events to trigger the Lambda function, specifically when you upload to S3? Do you happen to know what, via serverless, what would be the command to use this as an event trigger?
So you want to, when you invoke locally, you mean?
Yeah, so if I'm, let's say I'm uploading data onto a bucket and that makes me want to trigger my training process, for example.
Yeah. Oh, so inside the serverless YAML, it's quite easy to define different event triggers. So there's an S3 event trigger. Don't ask me about the details, but you can say something to the extent of if there is something put, like a put event on this bucket ABC, then trigger this Lambda, and this event would then get sent into the Lambda. And I can show you a neat little trick where you can see what kind of events actually arrive at the Lambda, so inside the event code. So if you are in the AWS Lambdas here, can select a test event, and then they have event templates, and then you can say S3, there's a put event, and I don't know if you see that, but then this would be inside this event that comes into the handler, would be like this. It would be contain records and all kinds of crazy stuff, and also says, this is the bucket I received it, and it says like, this is the key and the file size. So, and you can test this locally if you just take this and when you do this serverless invoke local, you just take this and use it as the data input, because in the end, this is what your Lambda is invoked with.
Quite a naive question maybe, but the first time you run it, it's obviously going to take a while to do the setup, and then as long as you keep hitting it, it will stay kind of ready. Do you have an idea of kind of what, at one point Amazon will kind of wonder whether you're coming back or not, and it won't be ready anymore, right? So how long does it take until it just idles and then you have to reset all the whole thing?
So it's totally random how long that takes. Minimum is 5 minutes, because this is the maximum time that a Lambda can run non-stop. So if you invoke the code and you have some long computation, this can be a maximum of 5 minutes. So this is the minimum that the container where the code runs will be up. But I've seen that it stays active for like, I don't know, half an hour. If you're lucky, maybe an hour. But anywhere in between, most commonly 10, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Yeah, but it's totally random. It's just if AWS decides it needs the resources you're running your Lambda on somewhere else, it just throws away your container because it isn't running at the moment, instead of keeping it like in a ready state.
So for a production environment, you would be risking that every once in a while one prediction would take way longer than all of the others, right?
Yes. So this can happen. There will always be some request when it's served that experience a cold starting Lambda that will take longer. It can be a lot longer and it can be a little longer, depending on what you do to set it up. So if you unzip some dependencies at runtime, it's a lot longer. But there are ways to get around it. There are also plugins for serverless that just like ping a lambda or execute or invoke a lambda at steady intervals just to keep at least one instance warm every few minutes. But if you have a lot of concurrency, you cannot do that because you won't want to keep, I don't know, 1,000 instances like every few minutes because it's compute time that you waste. So yeah.
No more questions?
Yes, you want.
Can you make it predict spam?
Spam? Yeah. I can do that. So I'm just very I will just do it like this because I know or I hope that it will predict this as spam. But there could also be something else. I'm not sure. I guess maybe test is a spam. I don't know. Yeah. When we tested this, it was always returning spam, and nobody thought it would return ham. I don't know.
One question up here, all the way over there. Yep.
Could you pass it?
So, if I have, for example, a web application that runs on Elastic Beanstalk, and I have a model that is also deployed on Elastic Beanstalk, so there is no reason for me to use Lambda.
No, if your model already runs through Elastic Beanstalk, you don't need to use Lambda, but you can if you want to get rid of your instances that are running all the time, and also at times when you don't have any load on the instances. So if you want to save money that way, you can go serverless. Yeah.
Thanks.
Any more questions? Okay, let's thank our speaker.
All right, thanks.